Chase, and today I'm going to be talking to you about STIs for FTMs. I realize that it makes it sound like there are specific STIs that are only for FTMs, but that's not what I'm talking about here. This video is going to be part of my, like, sex ed series that I'm starting because, you know, I have so many series, might as well just make more. I decided to make this video because there is no information out there for trans men who are sexually active or any information about STIs. There is some, okay, I will say there is some information. A lot of it is geared towards queer men, and a lot of it is like not easy to find online. And it's very hard when you look at all of this sex ed information and you're trying to figure out like, what side do I look at, the male, the female, I don't know. So I'm kind of here just to try to shine some light on some of the issues that we have with sex ed and like just trying to like spread the knowledge that I have gathered over the years. And because of Google, thank you Google. So this topic is about STIs specifically. I will be talking about the three main categories of STIs. I will also be talking about HIV. This video is not meant to like understand how sex works, but it's really meant to understand how STIs work, and especially for our bodies, because I find that it's really tricky, and I've seen a lot of questions about this on FTM Sex Talk, the blog that I run with some friends, and the questions that we always get are always related to, do I look at the symptoms for men or do I look at the symptoms for women? And this is the question. This is what, I'm not trying to answer this question, but I'm trying to maybe explain, I don't know, I feel like people don't really look up like what STIs are, and a lot of people in the States don't have proper sex education on STIs and like other sexually transmitted infections and stuff like that. And I feel, like even in Canada though, like I had sex ed twice, and do you think that I know all of the things that I have learned over the years? No. I had to research it myself because I like to know things, and I also wanted to be 100% accurate in this video, but know that I will not be 100% accurate. This is just from the information that I have gathered over the years and have gathered from the Googles. Now, obviously, before I even start this video, which I already did, I'm sorry, you're 2 minutes in and I forgot to disclaimer, like, the biggest disclaimer ever. This video may be hard to watch if you're a trans man who has a lot of dysphoria surrounding those genitals. I am saying this because there are some words that I absolutely have to say, and I can't say your bottom or like the front hole or anything like that. I can't say those words for some of the specific things. I will try, and I have tried as hard as I can. I have written down as much information as I can that doesn't like describe the area as much as possible, but it describes it in other ways. But you need to know, like, trigger warning for real, like disclaimer, words will be used. Words that start with V that you are not comfortable with, sometimes I will have to use these words. I'm just gonna say it. I just have to. And it makes me uncomfortable sometimes to use it, but I'm trying to provide education. I want to make sure that people know exactly what I'm talking about, especially because there's so much misinformation about STIs, and like, we need to talk about this because it's a problem. Because trans people are sexually active. Did you know that? Well, now you do. I'm also making this video to raise awareness about getting tested. Now, even if you just had sex once and you don't think you should get tested, after you watch this video, you're gonna wanna go get tested. Because there's a whole bunch of things that can happen to you and you won't even feel a symptom until 30 years! So let's go into talking about that. All right, so there are three different categories of STIs. There's parasitic, there's bacterial, and there is viral. Within these, we have different ones. Example, for parasitic, there's crabs and scabies, and then for bacterial, there's gonorrhea and chlamydia, and then for viral, there's HPV, HIV, and stuff like that. So that's what I'm gonna be talking about, and I'm gonna go through all these. You can get all this information online, absolutely, but I thought maybe making a video about the different ones, people will actually wanna watch it because I have cool hair, and maybe learn a little thing if they, you know, some people just like, they don't wanna know, right? They don't wanna Google it, they don't wanna know, you know, ignorance is bliss. I don't know, maybe just, whatever, I'm doing this anyways. We're gonna talk about this. Words are gonna be happening, let's do this. So what is a parasitic STI? A parasitic STI is basically a bug that lives on humans that you can't see with the naked eye. All right, so we have three in the category of parasitic. We have trichomoniasis. Ooh, that's a hard word to say, honestly. We have crabs and we have scabies. Trichomoniasis is a very common STI. About 70% of people who have it don't show any symptoms. It takes about 5 to 28 days, very specific, in order to see the symptoms pop up. Common symptoms include itchiness, irritation, soreness of the genitals, And it can also include discharge from the genitals that have an unusual smell. So to know if you absolutely have this STI, you have to go to a doctor to get tested. They're gonna do some lab tests on you. They're also gonna give you medication if it comes up positive. Just please understand that even if you were, if you test positive for trichomoniasis and you take medication, it doesn't, you don't have like an immunity to it later on, so you could get it later on and have to go through the same process. So the second and third one are crabs and scabies. These ones are very close to each other, where it's like little, scabies is little mites that live on you, and crabs, which is also known as pubic lice, is exactly that. What it does, it just causes a lot of pain and irritation at the area. So what you need to do is, once again, you could go to a doctor. And when I say could, I mean you should. Go to a doctor, they'll take it. Usually they can just do a visual inspection, but sometimes they have to do lab tests. And then in order to treat it, they will give you some, it's usually some topical cream or shampoo. All right, and now on to the second category of STIs, which is bacterial. This includes syphilis, gonorrhea, and chlamydia. So for these, there are things that are specific for women and specific for men. Now, this is where I come in and I tell you, I'm sorry, this might be triggering for a lot of people, but you need to look at the symptoms for women, because a lot of the symptoms for men are like swollen testicles and stuff like that, which we don't have, right? So I know that it is triggering, but you need to look at the symptoms for women. So that's what I'm gonna be focusing on here. All right, so let's talk about gonorrhea. Gonorrhea is usually transmitted through anal, oral, or frontal sex. If you do show symptoms, a lot of doctors and yourself may confuse it with a bladder infection. The reason for this is they have very similar symptoms. So the symptoms include burning and painful urination and discharge. And if you are a pre-T trans guy who is not on T or still has the monthly thing that is happening, what usually happens is bleeding between that week. There you go. And the issue here is that women typically don't show symptoms of gonorrhea. So that's where it becomes dangerous, because you don't know that you have it, but you can still transmit it to a partner. So how do you know if you have gonorrhea? Well, you absolutely, once again, you need to go to a doctor. Like I said, not everybody shows symptoms, so it's important to get STI tested regularly. So when you go to the doctor, they're going to do a urine sample. Now, some doctors prefer to do a swab in the cervix or in the mouth. I have had to, personal experience, I have gone to a doctor and the doctor wanted me 100% to do the swab instead of the urine test, because she said that it was more accurate. But honestly, you could just do the urine test. And if it comes up positive for gonorrhea, they're just gonna give you medication, which you need to take the whole way through. Just because you take the medication doesn't mean you're immune to gonorrhea. You can get it again in the future. And as for sex, you are able to have sex 7 days after your medication finishes. In order to make sure that you don't transmit it to a potential partner or partners. All right, so chlamydia is much like gonorrhea. They're very close together. With chlamydia, you get it transmitted the same way through anal, front hole, or oral sex. Now, once again, you don't always see symptoms. Some people don't see symptoms until weeks after they're infected, and if you do see symptoms, it's usually painful urination, it's usually discharge, and it's usually, if you are infected through the anal rectum area, then you'll have bleeding and discharge from the rectum. Once again, just like gonorrhea, chlamydia can be tested with a urine sample or a swab. Once you get a positive test, you will be given medication. Take the medication until it's done. You can have sex 7 days after the medication is finished. So with all this information, it sounds like gonorrhea and chlamydia are the same, but they aren't. The difference is that with chlamydia, you're actually, it's more of a discharge and painful urination, whereas gonorrhea, it's more of a painful burning and itching sensation. And although some of the symptoms are very similar, you are given different medication to treat each of them. So the third one is syphilis. Now, syphilis is usually transmitted through front hole, anal, or oral sex. It is usually mostly transmitted through sores on these areas, especially in the rectum and in the mouth. Now, syphilis is called the imitation disease because it has so many possible symptoms that a lot of people, and even doctors, before they test the patient, believe that it can be a different type of disease because it takes on so many different symptoms. So syphilis has three stages. The primary stage is when an individual gets a sore or multiple sores around the area where they were infected. So if you were infected in the anal area, then you will get sores in that area. This lasts about 3 to 6 weeks. Now the sores can go away on their own, but you still need to go see a doctor, even if they go away, because if you don't, then the syphilis will move to the second stage. So the secondary stage of syphilis includes the individual getting more sores around their mouth, around the anal rectum area, in the front hole area, and even some sores on the palm of their hand and the soles of their feet. Now these are not going to be itchy, but you can get symptoms that include fever, sore throat, lymph nodes that are inflamed. There's so many different symptoms that the secondary stage can take that's why it's called the imitation disease, because there are so many different diseases that have these common symptoms. Hair loss, headaches, muscle aches, weight loss, all of these plus the sores can go away on their own. But once again, you absolutely should go see a doctor if you have any of these symptoms. Especially the palms of the hand and the sole of the feet, because that is very common with people who have syphilis. Because if you don't get it treated, once again, it will move to the different stage, and this is the last stage that syphilis takes, I guess. So the latent or late stages of syphilis is very interesting because you could have it for years without knowing. For some people, it takes 10 to 30 years until they see symptoms. And once you get to the late stages of syphilis, that's when the symptoms get very intense and it is life-threatening. So some of these symptoms include difficulty coordinating your muscles, blindness, numbness, paralysis. It affects the internal organs and dementia. So in order to know 100% if you have syphilis, you need to go to a doctor and get tested. What they usually do is actually a blood test or a swab of the sore. And then if you do come up positive, they will give you medication and you won't have syphilis anymore. The only thing is that this medication cannot undo any of the things that syphilis has done to you. So any of those symptoms that I talked about that are permanent, if you have numbness of a leg because of syphilis, that cannot be undone with the medication to get rid of syphilis. All right, and now we're moving on to our third category of STIs, which is viral. This includes herpes, HPV, and HIV. The reason why a lot of people don't know that they have herpes, one, they don't get tested, but two, it mimics a lot of other types of, not diseases, but skin condition problems. This is the most common STI. But please remember that not everybody who is HIV positive will get to the final stage of HIV and develop AIDS.